a wonderful, wonderful prayer to sing before we hear the Word of God read and proclaimed to us. I'm departing this morning from our study in Exodus to meditate on something current in our culture, which I've already alluded to this morning, which is Pride Month. The LGBTQAI++ Pride Month. How should we think about this? How should we respond to it? What should we do? I can't answer every question about that this morning. That would be far too lengthy and comprehensive of mission to seek to accomplish in a short period of time. But let's take a crack at it. Leviticus chapter 18. This is our Old Testament reading this morning. Leviticus 18. If you're using the church Bible, it's page 178. Leviticus 18. This is the dustiest book in your Bible, probably. And, or one of. It's never too late to dust it off. You'll see if you're looking at the New King James, the editors gave the title of this chapter, Laws of Sexual Morality. So let me read this to you. I'll just read verses 1 through 24. And this is God's holy word. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, I am the Lord your God. According to the doings of the land of Egypt where you dwelt, you shall not do. And according to the doings of the land of Canaan where I am bringing you, you shall not do. Nor shall you walk in their ordinances. You shall observe my judgments and keep my ordinances to walk in them. I am the Lord your God. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man does, he shall live by them. I am the Lord. None of you shall approach anyone who is near of kin to him to uncover his nakedness. I am the Lord. The nakedness of your father or the nakedness of your mother you shall not uncover. She is your mother. You shall not uncover her nakedness. The nakedness of your father's wife you shall not uncover. It is your father's nakedness. The nakedness of your sister, the daughter of your father, or the daughter of your mother, whether born at home or elsewhere, their nakedness you shall not uncover. The nakedness of your son's daughter or your daughter's daughter, their nakedness you shall not uncover, for it is your own nakedness. The nakedness of your father's wife's daughter, begotten by your father, she is your sister, you shall not uncover her nakedness. You shall not uncover the nakedness of your father's sister, she is near of kin to your father. You shall not uncover the nakedness of your mother's sister, for she is near of kin to your mother. You shall not uncover the nakedness of your father's brother. You shall not approach his wife. She is your aunt. You shall not uncover the nakedness of your daughter-in-law. She is your son's wife. You shall not uncover her nakedness. You shall not uncover the nakedness of your brother's wife. It is your brother's nakedness. You shall not uncover the nakedness of a woman and her daughter, nor shall you take her son's daughter or her daughter's daughter to uncover her nakedness. They are near of kin to her. It is wickedness. Nor shall you take a woman as a rival to her sister to uncover her nakedness while the other is alive. Also, you shall not approach a woman to uncover her nakedness as long as she is in her customary impurity. Moreover, you shall not lie carnally with your neighbor's wife to defile yourself with her. And you shall not let any of your descendants pass through the fire to Molech, nor shall you profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Nor shall you mate with any animal to defile yourself with it. Nor shall any woman stand before an animal to mate with it. It is perversion. Do not defile yourselves with any of these things. For by all these things the nations are defiled, which I am casting out before you. Now let's turn together to Romans chapter 1, which will be a familiar passage to many of you. I would like to focus this morning just on five verses, verses 24 through 28, but I'll read to you verses 18 through 24. It's on page 1732 of the Church Bible, if you're using that. So again, we're going to focus in on Romans chapter 1, verses 24 through 28. But I'll read to you beginning in verse 18. And this is God's holy word. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed animals, and creeping things. Therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. And we'll stop there. This is God's word. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, how we need you to steel us and steady us, that we might determine ahead of time in our hearts that we will not sin against you, that we, though the whole world might turn against you, the whole world might call us to follow them in some other way, we will stand on the truth of your word. Make us willing, make us able, Father, for only in this way can your church be a city set on a hill and the salt of the earth, that we can preserve that which is dying and cast light to those who are shrouded in darkness. And so it is how important it is at this moment in our nation's history that we, as your holy nation, your church, that we would be distinct from the world and that we might be distinct for the world. And we ask that you would use us to reach those who are confused, whose minds are darkened, whose hearts are against you, that they might be saved. So equip us this morning from this portion of your word, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as you are probably well aware, June has been designated the LGBTQ plus Pride Month in the United States of America. I don't know who has the authority to do such things, but somebody does, I guess. And so you might see corporations even or government buildings even that are flying the gay pride flag or the transgender flag alongside of the red, white, and blue. And of course, pride parades are planned in cities all across America, and you'll see government leaders and celebrities and professional athletes in attendance and lending their name and their influence and to in support of such things. There's going to be a pride parade here in the city of Roseburg just in a few hours from now. And last June, the City Council of Roseburg declared June LGBTQ plus Pride Month for the city of Roseburg. And if you read the transcripts of the record of that meeting, you will know that the stated goal of doing so was to change people's minds. LGBTQ people and their allies have banded together to put tremendous amounts of pressure on people who believe that LGBTQ lifestyles are sinful. They're putting pressure on us right now, and perhaps you feel that. And the pressure comes in two primary forms. First, there is seduction. How does that work? Well, you see the beautiful people, the powerful people, the celebrities, and they use popular music or movies or media, whatever form, in order to promote and to normalize queerness, we might say. And there's pressure built into that. And what that subtly communicates, especially to you young people, is that if you want to be cool, if you want to be seen as relevant to the culture and the world around you, then you too have to embrace queerness as a good, healthy, and normal thing. So there, first of all, is seduction. And you're being seduced. The second way you feel this pressure is through persecution. Now, this is a way of pressuring us to accept and affirm these alternative lifestyles, as they might be coined or termed. And this persecution, which, by the way, if you read Revelation 13, read Revelation 13 this afternoon, you'll see the two ways that the devil always works to seduce people. Or to drive people away from the truth of God's word is seduction and persecution. Those are his two tools. He'll either trick your heart into believing what is false, or he will use brute force. Now, right now, in our nation, the persecution that those who stand fast to the truth of God's word, the type of persecution we experience is really just name calling, right? Bigot, hater, fascist, Nazi, racist, domestic terrorist. That one has a little more teeth to it. In some countries, even in our own, business owners who won't bow the knee to the agenda can be sued and are sued, and they're financially destroyed. Now, you can be censored on social media, and some LGBTQ people and their allies are openly calling for criminal penalties to be imposed on anyone who openly disagrees with queer lifestyles. Now, the pressure is mounting, isn't it, brothers and sisters? And my goal today is definitely not to stoke hatred towards anyone, the LGBTQ plus community. No, we don't hate them. We should love them. As Christians, we cannot affirm or condone their lifestyles, but we should see in them the dignity that they have as men and women who have been created in the image of God. And for that reason, we are to love them. We are to pray for them. We're to acknowledge that the only real difference between us and them is the grace of God that has been poured out upon our lives. We'll see that in our passage this morning. And we should desire to win them to the truth, to be a neighbor to them, to seek opportunity, to persuade them. And so my main goal today isn't to talk down at people or to vilify anyone. My goal today is to help us, especially you young people, to resist the pressure and to stand fast on the Word of God. I often remind you of what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, where he says that we are in a spiritual war, but the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. But we must learn, he says there, to cast down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. And here is what this section of Romans teaches us, he equips us to do. LGBTQ lifestyles are not something to be proud about. In fact, Romans 1 teaches us that these perversions of human sexuality are the predictable outcome of human pride. And they are, in fact, a form, Paul says here, a form of God's judgment, a penalty. Now, if we were to look at Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 23 in depth, and I've done that in the past, this is what you would hear from those verses, is that if you suppress the truth about God with a desire to do things your way, if you hold down the truth that you know Him and that you know His eternal power and glory, if you hold down the truth of God and you deny that you are dependent upon Him, that He is your Creator, you are His creature, if you do that, you will become foolish in your thinking. And your heart will become dark. Paul says there, if you deny your Creator, then you will begin to worship and serve created things rather than the Creator. And your mind will grow futile, dark, and empty. But that is only the beginning of it. What we see next in the verses I want to focus on this morning, Romans 1, 24 through 28, is that if you suppress the truth of God, that means you're holding down God and His truth. If you're trying to push God down like a beach ball under the water because you don't want to deal with Him, you don't want to submit to His call to righteousness, if you are doing that, then you will face these unavoidable consequences that are described here. It is as predictable as the tides of the ocean, or the sunset, or the sunrise. If you worship and serve the creation, including pridefully worshiping and serving yourselves and your own appetites and desires, if you do that, you will eventually begin exchanging what is natural for what is unnatural in every area of life. And this is part of the project that we see going on, the dismantling of what once was a Christian society. And the project is to remove God as king over all of life. And part of that project is rebelling against the way that He has obviously created things to work, right? And that is what is behind this accelerating push in our nation for all things queer to be celebrated by us. And we're supposed to ignore somehow that just 10 years ago, President Obama said in a nationally televised interview that he did not agree with gay marriage. That was just 10 years ago. At that time, there were only 7 states in which there was a legislation allowing homosexual marriage. And we know, of course, today it's the law of the land. Just 10 years ago, the psychiatric community still characterized a transgenderism, a mental disorder that people needed to seek treatment for and to be helped and shown compassion about. Now it's championed as a legitimate and healthy life choice. And the government in almost every quarter of our nation is bent on promoting this to even 3-year-old children. And young people, they tell us that this is progress. This is what progress looks like. Men can pretend that they are women. They can be surgically altered to somewhat appear like a woman, and then they get to go and dominate female sports, rewrite all the record books. That is progress. So we're told. They will tell you that it is progress that men can marry men and women can marry women. Somehow it's progress for humans to enter into this relationship, that if everyone did the same thing, humanity would go extinct in the course of one generation. Now that fact all by itself tells us that there is no life in these kinds of lifestyles. They're actually a form of death and suicide. Now, young people, you need the wisdom of God's Word to understand how all of this actually came about so that you won't be tricked or seduced into affirming and participating in these suicidal lifestyles. And what I want you to leave here with today is a compassion and a sympathy, though, for these people. I want you to be better prepared, not just to know how to respond to our neighbors who are increasingly headed in these directions. So young people, you need the wisdom of God. We need to be prepared to defend what we believe. And again, what is revealed here in Romans 1 is that these kinds of perversions that we are talking about, they are predictably present wherever human pride exalts itself above God and goes unrestrained. Worshiping and serving ourselves and creation rather than the Creator necessarily, Paul is saying here, necessarily creates confusion and foolishness in the human mind. And it translates into sexual confusion and unnatural behavior that we see in society. And it's predictable because the religious view promoted by our society is confused and unnatural. And that means, young people, that all of the disturbing change that we see going on does not, in fact, challenge the Word of God. It confirms the Word of God. What we are seeing happening right now proves that God's word is true. And we see from what we are told here that God is actually at work in all of this. Paul says, he says it in verse 24, that, and he's continuing his argument about those who hold God down, who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Paul says in verse 24, because men do hold down the truth of God in unrighteousness, because they change the glory of the God who never dies to worship things that do die, because humanity is on that foolish, futile, dark mission, God gives them over to it. He hands them over to it. And this is what Paul was talking about when he said in verse 18, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all the ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. It makes sense that God he's angry. He's justly angry with creatures who know Him, Paul says here. They know Him, but yet in proud self-centeredness, they reject Him and they reject His design for creation and for even our own bodies. In righteous anger, Paul says, he hands them over to their foolish way of thinking to experience the logical consequences of doing that. I remember in junior high, I had a friend who was proudly boasting at school that he had bench pressed 250 pounds when he was all alone in his basement the night before. And none of us believed that he could actually do that. But we couldn't get him to admit that he was lying. So we challenged him to prove it. We said, let's go to the gym at lunch and we will watch you do it all over again. So we backed him into a corner. And his pride just wouldn't let him back down on the lie that he was telling. And so he went to the gym with us and we set up 250 pounds on a barbell. We appointed someone big enough to spot him, and we let him try it. And predictably, the barbell landed on his chin. Yeah, it was very painful. But we didn't try to hold him back from doing what we knew would hurt him. We knew it was going to hurt him. In a way, we handed him over to his pride to expose the lie that he was living. And he couldn't deny it anymore. That's not unlike what Paul is saying God does here to those who refuse to think God's thoughts after Him and reject Him and suppress His truth. It's impossible to think rightly about the world in which we live without acknowledging and knowing God. Why? Because He created this world. This world is His, and we can't escape that reality. And you will only become empty and futile in your thinking if you attempt to build your life on anything but the Word of God. You may profess to be wise, Paul says, but you will become a fool. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You can't know what created things are for and use them the right way, including your own life, including your own body. You can't do that without knowing the Creator who made you and knowing His design, and then worshiping and serving Him as the one who made you. Again, we see this kind of naive foolishness in young children. Young children frequently break things in the house. How? By misusing them, not using them according to their design. And we had one time in our household, the child's name will remain unmentioned, but a child broke one of our TVs because the child used it as a pinata. And the TVs aren't pinatas, right? There's no candy inside. And right? If you misuse something, you destroy it. And so it is not just with TVs. It is with everything that God has created, even our own bodies. So when people suppress the truth of God to exalt their own appetites and their own pleasures, all of their thinking becomes foolish. When they look at the world, they no longer see God. They don't see His design. They don't see His purpose for things. And so what they do is they just go by their own feelings, their own urges, and their own appetites, pridefully believing that they can satisfy those urges and those appetites any way they see fit. And in time, God in His wrath will hand them over to that foolishness. And what does it look like? What does it look like when God hands a people over to their foolishness, the foolishness of rejecting them? Well, that is what Paul is describing here. I'll reread it to you. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. Even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. So there it is. God, he stops restraining the evil desires in a people. When they have run hard in the way of rejecting Him, the desire to worship created things, the desire to worship our own desires, to worship our own cravings of our bodies, those things were made for God. But He lets us run wild when we refuse to hear His voice calling us to come back. And Paul doesn't say here how God hands a people over to it. That's not the point that he is trying to make. The point he's trying to make here is that when people do reject the God who made them, they foolishly start doing things that they were never made to do. It's just logical, isn't it? And this unnatural lusting of men for men and women for women, what Paul calls vile passions in verse 26, is the predictable consequence of God handing people over to their desire to worship creation rather than the Creator. I know I'm sounding like a broken record. What I'd like to point out to you now is that this is a universal consequence. The consequence here is not only logical, it is universal, that people will unnaturally deny their knowledge of God to worship and serve themselves. Universally, this is the direction things go. Now, that's not just true of this moment in human history, it's true throughout human history. And Paul, he refers to in verse 25, the lie, and he uses the definite article. It is the lie. It's the lie that the devil used to overthrow Adam and Eve in the garden. What was that lie? that in the day that you disobey God's word and you eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the day you disobey God is the day that you will become God yourself. He contradicted God and made another promise to them. That's the lie. Worshipping and serving yourself as the creature rather than your creator is somehow going to bring prosperity to your life. That's the lie. And the reason that homosexuality and queerness and transgenderism are the most extreme yet logical and predictable consequence of unbelief is because of what unbelief is. Unbelief is about holding God down to hold up your passions and your desires in God's place. It is to say, God has no right over me. He has no right to tell me what to do or how to use my body or what my desires are for. No, I get to define that for me. I will define myself. Well, isn't the logical conclusion of that idea that we will believe, that people will come to believe that there are no boundaries? There are no boundaries for my passions or desires because I've essentially replaced God with myself. So if I'm born with a male body, that would seem on the surface of things to limit me to live life as a man. But I didn't decide that. If you're thinking like the unbeliever being described here in Romans 1, you're thinking, well, I didn't decide that. If your basic belief is that me and my desires are God, then I must have the freedom to choose whether I will be male or I will be female. And it goes the same for every aspect of human sexuality. Right now, few things are more obvious in the design of creation than the fact that males were made to couple themselves with females, one to one, right? They are perfect complements. But you will acknowledge and defend that idea, that obvious truth, only if you acknowledge that nature and nature's God is ultimately in control. But if I believe I am in control, then I must get to choose who I fit my body together with. And my desires are free, determined by no one but me. You see, choosing the homosexual lifestyle or the transgender lifestyle is the ultimate expression of human pride that exalts itself above God and above the knowledge of God. And so, whenever a culture has exalted human pride and passions above God, the perversions that Paul describes here become widely practiced. And this has been true throughout human history. Now, you heard it in Leviticus chapter 18, right? In Leviticus 18, before they entered the land of promise, the Lord said, don't do the things that the nations of the earth do. And then he gave a long list of, in the rest of the chapter, of vile sexual perversions that the nations of Canaan practiced, including, we heard there in Leviticus 18, homosexuality and bestiality even. And what we see when we look at history is that all of those unnatural practices were religious in nature. They were an outworking of the beliefs that those people hold to. You need to know this, that the LGBTQ plus agenda and community, it is a religious community. It is a religion. It's the expression of an idea. And there's a lot of research that has been done on this area in terms of looking back at history. But you might be shocked to find out how much like modern Western culture the ancient pagan world actually was. There's a theologian named Carl Bratton who has done a lot of research in this area on ancient pagan practices. And he described their beliefs, their basic beliefs of ancient paganism, as a belief that a divine spark or seed exists in the individual human soul. Salvation consists in liberating the divine essence from all that prevents true self-expression. The way of salvation is to turn inward and, quote, get in touch with oneself. Now, Ken Wilber, he is a leading advocate of people returning to ancient pagan practices. And he wrote, the ultimate secret, if we dare to state it so simply, is that there are no boundaries in the universe. Boundaries are illusions. And that's the same belief that we hear championed in our culture today. You can be whatever you want to be. You just have to proudly believe in you. There are no boundaries. No one can define you. Well, friends, that's just ancient paganism. And it's a universally held belief that the creature is to be worshipped and served rather than the creator. He can't put any boundaries on me. That's the lie that Paul is talking about here in Romans 1:25, the lie that Satan used to separate Adam and Eve from God. And it is no coincidence then that this universally held lie, if the lie is universal, that it produces universally the same results. A man named Mircea Eliade, he's a respected expert in comparative religions, and he argued that androgyny appears virtually everywhere and at all times in the world's in world religions throughout history. Now, what is this androgyny? Well, it, from the Greek, literally, it's two Greek words put together, andros and gyne, androgyny, and it literally means the man-woman. The man-woman. Androgyny is the combination of male and female characteristics in one person. It is to confuse together male and female together to destroy the distinction that God made between male and female. Now, you can see it in the new lines of clothing that are coming out, maybe at your Target store. We don't have one in town here, thankfully. But the clothes that blur the distinction between male and female, or clothes that allow a male to pretend that he's a female, or vice versa. That's androgyny, is what that is. Now, how was, and well, you might also have seen, there's a pretty centuries-old picture of the devil named Baphomet. And I don't know if you've ever seen a picture of Baphomet. Baphomet is a horned creature with a masculine body, masculine lower parts, but his chest is covered with breasts. He's an androgynist. He is the man-woman. Well, how is this androgyny practice, as Mircea Eliade said, in virtually every religion, everywhere? Well, historical records show that going back before the time that Israel even left Egypt, in both Mesopotamia and in Canaan, there were androgynous priests that served in temples to Ishtar or Sibel or Anat, who were female goddesses. And the androgynous priests were men who lived devoted to the goddess. And how would they do that? Well, they dressed like women. They were priests who dressed like women and lived in submission to the female power that they saw as dominant through the goddess. And to show their devotion to the goddess, those androgynous men served as prostitutes. And so men who were followers of the goddess would go to the temple to have intercourse with the androgynous priests. And this same practice was widespread in ancient Syria, Babylon, Egypt, Greece, and Roman cultures. And so Eliade and other researchers, as they detail this, they also say it's been found in European tribal culture from very early on, in the shamans of northern Siberia and Central Asian people, and even among American Indians. Scholar Robert Baum, writing in his book Homosexuality and World Religions, concluded that gender variant men have fulfilled a sacred role throughout the millennia. Emily Culpepper, she's a lesbian pagan witch, self-described lesbian pagan witch who teaches at the University of Redlands, says that she has discovered a spiritual role for homosexuals. They are shamans for a future age. because a homosexual is a quote, a charged, potent, awe-inspiring, and even fear-inspiring person who takes true risks by crossing over into other worlds. Rosemary Radford Ruther, a well-known feminist theologian, said, "Androgyny is her model for a human species liberated from dualistic gender to obtain psychic wholeness." Now, I could go on and on with quotes such as this, but you get the point, I think, right? That homosexuality, bisexuality, transgenderism are the ultimate expression of humanity unchained from God and His truth. And just as it was thought in ancient pagan religion, so it is now. If you are going to worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, then homosexuality, bisexuality, transgenderism, whatever it might be, will be viewed as the purest form of living. It is most consistent with the belief that the individual gets to define for him or herself who he or she wants to be. In other words, it's the ultimate way to tell God, "You will not rule over me." And that is why sexual confusion has been the norm wherever and whenever the truth of God is held down and human independence and autonomy is exalted. But when in judgment, God hands people over to the rebellious ways of thinking described here, these unnatural lifestyles abound and are practiced. And I think knowing that, young people, should be a great help to you. It's predictable. It's the predictable perversion of human pride. And notice in verse 27 that God's apostle says that these unnatural lifestyles are not what the LGBTQ community and their allies think that they are. They aren't a form of freedom that should be celebrated with pride. These lifestyles are a penalty. They are the penalty that is due to people who do not glorify God as their God and their Creator, who alone can tell us who we are and what we ought to be. The penalty for proudly exalting our feelings and desire above God. What is the penalty? It's more pride. It's more pride and rebellion. Another way to say this, it's like Pharaoh. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Then God hardened Pharaoh's heart. And there was no way out. The celebrations that we will see this month are living proof that Romans 1 is true and that God is at work. God is, sadly, what this means, friends, is that God is judging our nation. God is judging our nation for its pride and its suppression of Him. Pride Month is a living parable to those who are wise, to those who have ears to hear. And what does it say to us? It says, if you suppress the truth of God with a proud desire to do things your way, if you worship your appetites and your desires instead of Him, you will become a fool who is consumed with what is unnatural. And it will be to your destruction. Now, brothers and sisters, God teaching this to us about the predictable confusion and shame that results from rebellion against God, God doesn't teach this to us to make us proud or to make us hateful or to make us mean towards unbelievers. This is actually meant to humble us and to make us sympathetic towards those who practice such things. And Paul says as much in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, which I'll read to you now. Listen, "Therefore you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. For in whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge practice the same things. But we know that the judgment of God is according to truth against those who practice such things. And do you think this, O man, you who judge those practicing such things? and doing the same that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance?" And so Paul says here, we do the same things. That in our hearts too, we want to suppress the truth of God in our unrighteousness. We want to live our own way. The only difference between us as Christians and those who are that Paul is describing here in chapter 1 is that God didn't hand us over to our unbelieving ways. He has been patient, leading us by his kindness and by his goodness to repentance. Paul is not saying here that we are not to make moral judgments, that we aren't to call sin sin. He's not saying that. He's just saying to each one of us, humble yourself before the mighty hand of God too. Submit to his judgment about you as well, and recognize that his patience, his goodness, his forbearance, his long-suffering is to lead people to repentance. Now, it's our privilege to imitate him in this with our neighbors. And this doesn't mean we are not authorized in God's word to become allies with the LGBTQ community and to support their agenda. No, we cannot affirm these lifestyles. For their sake and for the sake of God's glory, we must uphold the truth that these lifestyles are unnatural and they are destructive. But we can, can't we? We can sympathize with people who are enslaved by them. If not for the grace of God, I too would be on that path. We can sympathize with them. We can be good neighbors to them. And if people are going to be changed and drawn out of this movement, I don't think it's going to be from Christians holding up megaphones and yelling at people from a distance. I think it's going to come through neighbor-to-neighbor contact. Without condoning or affirming their sin, we can love them, we can serve them, remembering that it was the goodness and kindness of God that led us to repentance. And so we need to remember, don't we, that Jesus dined with sinners? That Jesus dined with sinners. It was his humble kindness that drew sinners to him. It was his kind acts towards them that created the opportunity for him to tell them about their sin and their need to repent. It was his kind willingness to die in the service of sinners that draws sinners towards him and empowers us to change. And so we see Jesus, he wasn't afraid to get close to and even to touch lepers, right? Because Jesus' power was so unstoppable that the leper would be purified rather than Jesus being polluted. And 2 Timothy 1:7 says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So I would say if the Spirit of God dwells in us, we need not fear what is unholy. We must guard our hearts as we approach those who practice it. But we should desire to see Jesus heal and cleanse those who are defiled by these sins as he touches them through us. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we ask you, O Lord, to give us wisdom, first into the condition of our own hearts and how apart from your grace, Lord, we would suppress the truth about you in our unrighteousness. We would, seeking to go our own way, we would replace you with our appetites and desires. And Father, we've done that. Each one of us here is guilty. And so, Lord, give us a holy sympathy for those who are ensnared in such things. Lord, though make us jealous for your holiness and your glory and your truth. Oh Lord, how much we need much wisdom to hold these two things together at the same time, both your radical holiness and your demands for righteousness and approaching sinners with love and grace. We do ask, O Lord, that you would help us, O Lord, that we might not be ensnared ourselves with this way of thinking, especially for our young people, Lord. We ask that they might not be seduced by the powers and the spirit of the age, but, Lord, that they would become gracious, loving, yet bold soldiers of the cross. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to stand and sing number 488. Just